What I looked at in the exhibition and also in the research for it was what her work was about and her influences. And clearly she was Scottish, and Scotland remained a really important part of her life for the whole of her life. And although she lived in St. Ives for the bulk of her life, she never lost those connections. But it was also to investigate the source of her work, how she arrived at her own voice. And it seemed to me that the Scottish tradition in which she was taught was really vital and important, and would give a different slant on her preoccupations with things like drawing and her sense of colour, which was extraordinary. And also the importance of that connection to her, what Scotland gave her throughout her career. So I felt it was a rounding out of the story of Barnes Graham. There was a sense in the sort of narrative of where she fitted in St. Ives that Wilhelmina Barnes Graham, who I'm going to refer to as Willie from now on, Willie arrived in 1940, as it were, as an open book, and that the people that she encountered there were her main influences, not just then, but for the rest of her life. So we're talking about Ben Nicholson and Barbara Hepworth and Naam Gabo in particular. And I felt that that was only part of the story, and that by exploring the importance of her training and who she was taught by, that we might achieve a different aspect of what she arrived in St. Ives with. So in her portfolio, in her bag when she arrived in St. Ives, was a whole gamut of influences and people that she had drawn inspiration from. So she went to Edinburgh College of Art. She was taught by the people who we associate now as Scottish colourists. And she had a very traditional training, which really hadn't changed much since the 18th century. And that training was based on drawing. Nothing happened until you could draw, and the drawing was the basis of all else that followed. And of course, drawing was incredibly important for Willie throughout her years and her whole career. So drawing was the basis of this education that she received at Edinburgh College of Art. She was taught by people like William Gillis, John Maxwell, Peplow for a short while. And they had a very cosmopolitan approach to art, because at that time Scottish students and tutors were very closely associated with Paris and with Europe in a way that really wasn't the case in England. So they already had this kind of European tradition. So she knew about Cézanne and Klee and Kokoschka and all these crucial European artists before she arrived in St. Ives. And there had been exhibitions in Edinburgh of Klee, who was very important to her in her development. So her colour was central. And colour wasn't just about her training, but it was also about what colour meant in the tradition of Scottish painting. And one of the things that she talks about immediately when she arrives in St. Ives is the light. And she had been born in St. Andrews, and the light in St. Andrews, in the northeast of Scotland, and the light in St. Ives, they seemed to her very similar. So she recognised that quality, and that light gives colour a great intensity. And so she recognised that and felt that it was like a coming home, in a way, going somewhere that's familiar to St. Ives. So those were the reasons why I felt it was important to explore the background of who she was before she became involved in the St. Ives story of British modernism.